one of the first lorries that I, well, the only lorry actually as I'm driving, it was a Morris, and it was used during the Second World War to tow artillery. It was a dedicated artillery tractor, and it used to tow the 25-pounder gun and limber. And it had four-wheel drive, constant four-wheel drive. You didn't have to engage it. And it had a four-cylinder Morris petrol engine, about 3.5 litres. And they were notoriously slow. And the gearboxes used to growl and they were noisy. But then that wouldn't affect Coogan because he took the whole back of it.
Yeah.
And all you had really was you had the front windscreen and the front side panels, and there was no, absolutely no protection from the weather at the back or the sides. Okay. And he had mounted a crane on it, driven by the winch of the Morris. But it was a fierce reliable old yoke. But I was told that he bought that behind in Castle Island from Dennis Burke. Dennis was used to buy ex-army stuff, and he had a place beyond Limerick as well, and he used to journey from Castle Island to Limerick every day. And Coogan got to hear about this Morris commercial anyway, and he himself and Dennis had a deal anyway, and that's how the Morris wound up here. Or he used to
tow and stuff
to tow his trailer.
Tow his trailer. Right.
And also for breakdowns, it was a breakdown truck as well.
Okay.
And if anybody got stuck anywhere, it had a winch front and back.
Okay.
And he could winch them out. And he also used the gibbet crane to load timber.
Right.
Which was kind of an all-round vehicle. And he taught Liam and his mother, I believe, how to drive it. I'm not quite sure about that now. Liam said that at one stage.
Yes.
But a lot of Second World War stuff wound up in the commercial field in one sense. Limerick County Council now, for example, bought a whole pile of the Canadian military pattern trucks, and they used them as tow trucks, prime movers. They used them for winching out stuff. I think they had a few of them converted to snow plows, and they used them as, you know, if the roads got really bad.
Yeah.
And some of those wound up with Coogan.
Okay.
Because he had a great old leg of the council, because he did so much work for him.
Yes.
But they had been converted to, they were petrol engined originally. They were about a 3.5 litre petrol engine, four cylinder. And Coogan's one, he changed it to a diesel. He fitted a Hercules four cylinder diesel engine to it. And sure, it was going like a clock.
Yeah.
Yeah, you wouldn't hear it.
Right.
But I was a good old make out because he sold the engines that came out of the Fords and the Chevrolets that he got, and people they fitted them to tractors and made tractors more powerful.
Yeah.
They altered the chassis of the tractor.
Nice.
The engine bearers of the tractor.
Yeah.
So he also did all the winch gear and whatever on that truck there that was always beside the mill, opened the clint. But he never actually ran it.
Okay. Right.
He'd run it. He'd run the engine on, right? But I never saw him driving it.
Okay.
Or it was a Chevrolet.
Yeah.
It was a Canadian military pattern Chevrolet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You see, in the Second World War, the British, when they pulled out of Dunkirk, they lost most of their transport, naturally enough. They couldn't bring it with them.
Yeah.
And but prior to that, they had asked the Canadian Ford and Chevrolet to make these standardized trucks that would use the same parts on board. And they developed this truck in a way that became known as the Canadian Military Pattern. And most of the parts were interchangeable. Ford had its own engine, Chevrolet had its own engine, but other than that, everything else was interchangeable.
Okay.
So it made it very easy to maintain spares and very easy to. And they had different capacities. They had 1500 weight, a 1300 weight, and a 3 ton. And some of the 3 tons then were tandem axles in the back. But they were all either 4 or 6 wheel drive.
Okay.
And they were highly reliable. And as I say, one of those wound up with Jackie, you know. And
yep.
They were an unusual truck in the sense that they had a, well, the Type 13 cab, which is Jackie's one, was most peculiar because the windscreen sloped back rather than out.
Okay.
But there was a reason for that, I finally found it out a few years ago, that if you had a windscreen sloping back, it didn't reflect the glare of the sun.
Okay.
And it made the truck less obvious.
Yes.
Whereas if you had a...
Okay.
It would reflect the sun, and aeroplanes or whatever could possibly see it. That was the reason for it.
Yes.
Oh, but they were gee, boys. There was no comfort in them anyway, that's for sure.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, he did, yeah, because... above where he, in the mill now, where he used to sleep, at one stage he had a whole pile of machinery markets. They were a publication that were brought out every month, and they'd have all the machinery for sale in Ireland and England. But as well as that, it would they would have descriptions of machines and various, you know, technical descriptions and whatnot.
Okay.
But he read those.
He devoured them, so.
Devoured those.
Yep. Okay.
At one stage, he actually, there was like a wall around his bed. And he kind of had the door made through the books. Well, he was... But the one thing he never did now, in all fairness, and he should have done it, he had a stove above, a small cast iron stove, with a pipe going up, and it was always smoking. He never bothered his tail end correcting the lack of draft in it.
Right.
And you'd go in, and he'd only be after getting up, so you'd have to wait. And he'd do his wash up. Mm-hmm. He used salt instead of toothpaste. He'd rub it onto his teeth and then he'd wash his teeth out. He didn't use butter. He'd get a slice or a pan of bread, and he had a special hacksaw blade above that he'd cut the pan with. And just, I'd say he'd nearly used the calipers to sort it would all be the same. And he'd have tea then, without any milk or sugar. And since then, he lived to be about 98.
That's right.
And would have lived for longer.
Yeah.
Well, he'd been knocked down.
That's a shame.
He used to always say then that he was born on Orange Man's Day, the 12th of July. That was his birthday. I can't remember
name of the brother that was at home. He had a farm at home.
Mm-hmm.
Mickey was an unusual man too.
Mm-hmm.
He was a carpenter and roofer, and he could climb anything.
Right.
Okay. He used to climb above in the square now, the three-story houses like Jimmy Lee's and that.
Yeah.
With an ordinary ladder.
Okay.
He'd climb up onto that and do a job on the roof.
Right. I think my father was saying the town used to have a ladder itself at that stage.
Oh, they had, yeah.
Yeah.
They used to rent it out to people.
Rent it out, yes. Mm. Mickey was always living in Crane, Sawshine, I suppose.
Oh, he was, yeah. But he had a kind of a workshop above the back of Jack's as well.
Yeah.
He used to make coffins up there, among other things.
Okay.
But I showed you the article about the famous race between Coogan's father, Mickey, and the blacksmith above from Monaghair. Forgotten his name again now. But they say Mickey should have won, but he was tripped up by Newcastle hooligans because I think some of them had a bet on.
Well, did that race take place, Shang?
All around the town.
Around the town, okay.
Yeah. That was an account of it in the Old Limerick Journal.
Was there?
There was, yeah. Said that Coogan told her that his sister had come from the States.
Okay.
And that he brought her up to his living accommodation, if you like to call it that.
That's it.
And he had a jot of a tree as a seat, and he had a plank across it. And she was above there sitting by the smoky fire in a forecourt, and the tears running down her eyes from the smoke. Because definitely, you know, you'd smell like a kipper after being above that.
That's right.
But he used to come down every Christmas then, a couple of days before Christmas, and he'd bring my mother a packet of players, 20 players, navy cut. She used to smoke. But that was his Christmas present for her.
Okay.
And it was the only time I ever saw him taking a drink. He'd have a bottle of stout, and if you were really pressed him, he'd have a second bottle of stout.
Okay.
But he was not a great man to take any drink or whatever, you know.
Okay.
All right, yeah.
And then he'd...
Oh, well, he'd warm it a slight bit on night, yeah.
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 But he actually wouldn't mull it like
okay,
such,
right.
Yeah. Well,
great memories of him, and he was a kind of a definitely a formative influence on my life in a way. If you wanted to turn anything now, he'd use the fireball, or he'd use it to shape something, or temper something like that.
Right.
But he hated the welder, and he preferred to bolt anything together, or rivet it together.
Okay.
And sometimes I used to be blackguarding him, and I suppose I'd say, will I bring up the welder jack and weld up that piece of the truck for you? If off with that whole thing, he'd tell him. Didn't believe in it at all.
Yes.
I was doing writing a few words one time about Phelan's mill, and I, of course, I consulted Jack, and he could tell me the types of stationary engines there, the who worked there, who the electricians were, who the carpenters were, who the sawyer was, and he could describe the various machines they used for the corn grinding. And he was a total mine of information. And he then, of course, went on to explain the stationary engines, the different types. You know, you had an oil engine, which was a kind of a forerunner of a diesel, and had a single cylinder about 50 horsepower, and that was used to drive the dynamo that supplied the current to the town. And they eventually got another one from a quarry above in Galway, which was a twin cylinder, and they never actually got that going very well because frost, it was left out and it wasn't drained, and they got a heavy frost anyway on it, and it cracked the casing of the cylinder. But that was sold on anyway. But he'd explain to you then how the different types of engines, oil engines, hot bulb engines, gas engines, and as I say, he was an absolute expert.
Yeah.
And he was one of the few people that I, as a young fellow, met whom I would call a genius.
Okay.
And to me, he always was a genius, always will be a genius.
Right. Okay.